Good morning. I believe it's your day off today. Is that correct? So thank you for coming on your day off to have a conversation with me. We've been periodically doing trips. Sam, me, Milind, to the United States, to now Dubai, Germany, and we've been having conversations with students like you. You have lots of questions. Feel free to ask them. Don't worry about what question you're asking. My job is to give you answers, so relax and do that. I have a few views. I'll put them across to you through the questions, and then at the end of the discussion, I'll lay out a little perspective on how I think India is moving forward and how I think we could do better. So please go ahead and start your questions.
Yes. Who has the microphone? How is that going to work?
Good morning, sir.
Yes, where are you?
Right here.
Okay.
So
I think the best thing would be those who have to ask questions line up there. That may be better as opposed to moving microphone all along. Okay? Yes, go ahead, please.
So my question is regarding brain drain. So do you think brain drain is really that big a problem from India, or can we look at it as a positive paradigm shift?
Brain drain, in my view, was a 20th century idea. In the 21st century, I don't think brain drain works exactly the same way, because people are much more mobile. People are able to move to different places. So they go where the opportunity is. So the real idea is, in my view, not to worry about brain drain, but to make sure that you have opportunity in your country so that people from all countries come and see your country as providing opportunities. So I'm not one of those people who thinks that, you know, brain drain is such a problem in the 21st century. I mean, for example, all of you here, many of you are Indians. You're studying in Dubai. You will be connected to India, even though you're here. You've not gone away from India. Your connections are in India, and you'll act as hubs. You'll act as ambassadors for India. You will tell people. I remember when I first went to the United States, to Harvard University. People didn't really know India. People didn't really understand what India was. I mean, we used to get very strange questions, which, you know, you certainly won't get today. I mean, I remember when I was in college, we used to get questions like, you know, why do elephants walk on your streets? You know, and that the understanding of India that has come today, that's come because of what one calls brain drain. What is the value of that? For a country like India, that's a huge value. So I think you don't harm by connecting with people. And in the 21st century, you're going to move around much more. So I think it's a good thing. Now, if India provides tremendous opportunity, then people who study abroad will come home, like in Bangalore, like in Pune. But if India doesn't provide opportunity, then brain drain is a problem. So our job is to make sure that we are providing opportunity for youngsters in India, and we are providing opportunity for people from outside to come in and take advantage of some of the benefits that India provides. That's really where our focus should be. And if we fail there, then absolutely brain drain is a problem.
Oh. A very good morning, sir. Here, over here. To your left. To your right, sorry. To your right, here.
To your right,
yeah. Hi. So my question is like many...
Can you introduce yourself?
I am Praveen.
Yeah, Praveen.
So many countries allow their citizens to vote outside their home country. And here we are a lot of NRIs here. So what's your take on NRI voting and how the process will be?
I think as far as representation of NRIs goes and the idea of giving them representation in India, I think that's a good idea. NRI voting, I think that's a complex issue because there are many stakeholders in India who have views on that. But my view is that we should move towards it. You see, because a lot of people in India, and I don't necessarily agree with this, but a lot of people in India feel that there should be a difference between people who live in India and people who live outside India with regards to the rights that they're given back home, the access that they're given back home. That's a view. I think India is more than a geography. I think India is a particular way of looking at the world, a particular set of ideas. So I don't like to restrict the concept of India just with the boundaries of India. I think, you know, I feel that I'm sitting in India right now talking to a little piece of India. That's how I view it. That's not how many other people view it.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
Can we go back? Can I ask questions?
Yes.
Am I allowed? Okay, so I have a question for you. One view is that India is a geography. India is bound by a physical boundary. Another view is that India is a set of ideas. You'd agree that India is a set of ideas?
Set of ideas, definitely.
So what ideas do you think encapsulate the idea of India? What is the essence of the idea of India?
Togetherness.
Togetherness,
diversity, and unity in diversity, rather. That is the
what does that mean?
Phrase.
Sorry to put you on the spot. Because I remember once, when I was a kid, somebody had come to see my father. And my father said this. My father said, India's strength is unity and diversity. And they said, how can you have unity and diversity? How does it work? Because by definition, diversity should not result in unity. It should actually, you know, similarity should result in unity. So how does it work that in India, you can have so many different ideas and then you can still have unity?
So no matter what the ideas are or how diverse or whatever languages or cultures, at the end, it is the India that resonates with everybody. So that is the one unifying factor.
So for example, when you say I'm Indian, what does that mean? I can ask tough questions, huh? So what does it mean for you when you say I'm Indian?
It's an identity feeling with which I associate myself with the country, and a sense of belongingness. So.
And where are you from in the country?
So Calcutta, West
Calcutta. Bengali. So you're a Bengali as well?
Yes, sir.
So you're Indian and a Bengali. Yes. Which one comes first?
Indian, definitely.
When I say I'm an Indian, and somebody asks me, you know, what does that mean? My response is that India has taught me to look at a point of view that is completely different than mine, which I might even dislike and respect it. That India does not attempt to force one idea on top of people. And India can absorb ideas. So if you look at India, you'll see that ideas have come into India and then they've been shaped by India and India has been shaped by them. So it's a process that carries on. And that's something even in business. Open mind and say, okay, let me listen. Then you make mistakes. So that also is the idea of India. That you listen to other people, you hear them deeply, you understand where they're coming from, and then you build a consensus that produces a powerful result. Now, sorry, go ahead and ask a question.
So how do you think the education system in India should be changed so that the youth could be more empowered?
Yes. I think the education system in India has some very solid strengths, particularly at the cutting edge. So when you look at the IITs and other institutions like that, you have some tremendous institutions that can act as models, can show the direction. But then you also have in India a large number of institutions that are nowhere near what they should be doing. And I think the focus should be in transforming those institutions. India, during the UPA time, we took huge strides in enrollment of students in schools. And we had a number of programs that brought a lot of students in. So there was a massive jump with regards to enrollment. Quality of our primary education, particularly in the northern states, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, Bihar, Jharkhand, very poor. Whereas if you look at primary education in South India, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, even Maharashtra, some very innovative work going on. So it's a mixed bag. So how do you feel coming to Dubai, such a modern city, and sort of studying in this wonderful institute? What is the feeling? What are you thinking? How are you feeling?
Hello, sir.
Huh? Yeah.
Dubai. I've been in the Gulf since 2005, and it's like second home to me. What I love most about this place, and of course this college too, is that it's a confluence of the best of two worlds. It has the luxuries of the West and the culture and the tradition of the East. So I'm away from home, but I don't miss home. That is what the beauty of this place.
And your parents are in India or in Dubai?
My parents are currently based in Qatar.
Qatar, okay.
Yes. And okay. I'm studying here.
So you, and what are you going to do once you're done with education?
I will probably, like, when I land a job, I would like to work in
what type of
India
a job?
Or abroad. Sorry?
What type of a job? Politician?
I haven't given
it's a hard job, huh? Let me tell you. It Sorry? Looks easy, but it's not that easy.
I'm sure, sir. I'm sure you understand more. So I'll probably get into a management role since I'm an MBA student. For 2 years from now, I'll be an MBA graduate. That's probably the role.
And any company or any place, you, any organization or any specific?
Not really thought of it yet, but I'm open to whatever comes my way.
Large company or startup?
Would like to experience both. There's both. Learning everywhere. Both is equally opportunistic for me.
And what have you learned? What have you learned in the Middle East? How is it different than being back home?
It's different because so back home nobody really asks where I come from. In the UAE, I represent a place, a culture, a society. And it's immense responsibility on me to be here and to bring a good face to my country.
That you're an ambassador.
Responsibility, yes.
You're like an
ambassador. I'm an ambassador in that sense. So that responsibility that comes to me, that sense of responsibility came after I moved out of India.
And what would you advise leadership in India to look at? What do you think are the challenges, and what do you think that we should be focusing on?
The leadership should probably stem from it should come from the people. I mean, the thoughts of the leader and their people. We need coherence there. I mean, the leader should get down to the level of the people, understand them, truly know their grievances and take initiatives to address them right from the root to the top. That's what I feel.
So he needs to listen.
Yeah, they need to listen. They need an ear.
And any specific area that you think India needs to focus on? I mean, healthcare, education, defense, I don't know, anything?
So, a lot of them. There are.
What would be your, if you were the Prime Minister of India?
There's definitely a lot of scope improvement. Sorry, sir?
If you were the Prime Minister of India, what would be your three focus areas?
My base would definitely be education and research.
Education and research.
Because that is fundamental to our country. And we as Indians, as Asians, have always been seen as the competitive, the education-oriented people. And I think that's where our strength lies. So building up on the strengths, maybe overcoming the weaknesses through that.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Can I ask my question now?
Yeah, go ahead.
So, UAE gives importance to its holistic development through ministries of tolerance and happiness. Do you think a similar concept could be emulated by the Indian government for the Indian people?
Absolutely. I think tolerance is embedded in our culture. And it's quite sad to see what has been going on back home over the last 4.5 years, 5 years. A lot of intolerance, a lot of anger, division between communities. I think it stems from the mentality of the people who are leading. I don't think it's so much whether you have a ministry of tolerance or you don't have a ministry of tolerance. If the leadership is tolerant, they will act in a tolerant way and they will spread that message. I mean, a ministry is not a bad idea. But if you have a leader who's intolerant, you can have a ministry of tolerance. It doesn't matter. It won't work. So I think that's something that India generally tends to be tolerant, tends to listen. And we need to go back to that because it's what has actually made us strong. When a President Obama says India is challenging the United States, when he says that India and China are the future, huge part of the reason India has occupied that space is because of its tolerance. Because India has tended to carry everybody together. All religions, all states. I mean, you know, the girl who asked the question just earlier said she was from Bengal. I mean, if you look at Bengal, Bengal is the size of a middle income country. It's 80 million people. So it's a huge country in itself. Uttar Pradesh is 200 million people. There's only 5 or 6 countries that are bigger than Uttar Pradesh. And India brings these huge states, which are like countries together, peacefully. And look at Europe's experience. Europe is a similar complexity. If you look at European history, it's been at war with each other. Countries have been at war with each other. We have a political union. We have an economic union. And we've done it non-violently, completely non-violently. So that is our ethos and something that we should be very proud of. But we take it for granted. So it's only when it doesn't exist that you start to see its power. And that's what is visible today in India. And I think that's what we're trying to fight and that's what we're trying to change. We don't like an India which is divided. We don't like an India where people are beaten up and killed for what they say. We don't like an India where journalists are shot. That's not the India we're used to. And so that is the real challenge in the next election. And large numbers of people in India are not happy with what is going on there. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good morning, sir. So over here, to your right.
Yeah.
Hi, sir. My name is Paras. And sir,
hi, Paras.
Hi. And sir, when we think about the youth development through sports, so how do you view it? And you know that India has been a sleeping giant in the sports arena for a long time. There are many sports where we can dominate or participate in actively, but we are not there right now. So what are your viewpoints on it? How can we improve it to get some kids also out of their financial instability and get them a better future prospect? And also, sir, we are aware that you're quite a fitness freak yourself. So would you share some light on that?
share what I do exercise wise or?
So just your viewpoints on it.
Okay. Cricket is a big success in India. I mean, that's pretty clear to everybody. And it's a success because it has been scaled up. And it's and a network has developed that brings in lots of cricket players and allows them to thrive and demonstrate their skills through the IPL. That's the way forward. Access to large numbers of kids into different sports will make you powerful at sports. And I think there's some really big success stories. So there's a lot of success stories out of Haryana, and that's in sort of the, you know, wrestling, weightlifting, that space. Cricket is a success story. A lot of success stories in the Northeast. Mary Kom, very good boxer. Some very good archers in the Northeast. And it's all been done when you've sort of broken the monopolies and opened out access of sports to kids. Of course, when you're talking about competing at the world level, then income also matters. So for a country like India to compete with a country like the United States at the Olympics, it's difficult because the amount of money they can put in, the amount of support they can give to their athletes, we simply can't do. And it's harder to make sports number one priority in India when you have hunger, when you have other much bigger issues. But I think overall India is on a good trajectory when it comes to sports, opening out and creating a mentality where youngsters want to play sports is the key. I've always done some sporting activity or the other. So when I was small, I used to do taekwondo, karate, swimming. Recently, I do aikido. Do you know, you've heard of aikido? It's a Japanese martial art, so I'm a black belt in that. And then I run every day. It's non-violent though. It's not a violent martial art. It's a non-violent martial art. And it's more of a philosophy. It's very interesting from a business perspective as well, because it teaches you how to use your opponent's strengths and do so non-violently. In college, I used to box and play football. So that's overall what I used to do.
Good morning, sir. This side. Hi. Good morning, sir. So you mentioned about China and India being the growing giants. So China has already proved themselves. Now, after you the power, so what would be the industry that you would focus on?
I think there are opportunities. Healthcare is a huge opportunity for India. And I don't mean healthcare just as in building hospitals. I mean thinking about healthcare strategically from a national and global perspective. How you think about healthcare data, how you think about providing cheap medicines, and thinking about how India relates to the global economy with regards to healthcare. We are sitting on the biggest genetic resources on the planet. Much like Saudi Arabia has oil, we have the most complex DNA structures on the planet. And that is what cure and medical health is going to be about 10, 15 years from today. So we need to make those type of large scale plans. Much like what Mr. Sam Pitroda did in telecoms, we need to think strategically about what we can do in healthcare. Air transport is another one. Radically transforming agriculture. Currently, our agricultural system is not connected to the global economy. And it's very weakly connected to the Indian economy. Huge amount of wastage in food. Huge amount of wastage, vegetables and fruits. So building a cold chain, building a agricultural corridor, connecting the farm to the plate, making it possible for Indian farmers to send their products to people in Dubai. So that would be, the agriculture one is not an option, it's a necessity. So that's the second thing. Telecoms, IT, software, those are already places where we are pretty successful. And then moving from a focus on 10, 15 big companies to empowering thousands and thousands of small and medium entrepreneurs. So reshaping the banking system so that small and medium companies can get financial resources and actually scale up and become large companies. If you look at India's record at moving companies from small and medium size to large size is terrible. Almost no small and medium companies transition into large companies. Whereas if you look at the Chinese, most of their billion-dollar companies arose out of small and medium-sized companies. So that's something that we have to focus on. And then empowering guys like you. What do you want to do?
I'm currently doing my majors in marketing. So like you mentioned about the air transport, we have a success story here in Emirates. So
yeah,
like building something like Emirates in
India. It's a brilliant example.
Yeah.
I mean, what the UAE, countries like Turkey have done with their air transport systems, fantastic. And we have to do similar stuff back home. Much more complex, the rules, regulations in India with regards to air transport, much more complex. I'll tell you a story. I'm actually a pilot. And at one point I started to look at the questions and the syllabus of the pilot exam in India. And in the book, in the exam, I mean, one of the questions was, how do you drop postage from an aeroplane? This was, 15 years ago. The thing is that you stopped dropping postage from aeroplanes 40 years before that. But it's still an exam on the Indian. It's still a question on the Indian exam. It's ridiculous, right? So some of those things are sort of quite hard to change. They're bureaucracies, they're sort of not fast moving. So that's where one has to focus. Big issue with air transport in India is number of airports. And the connectivity between different cities as far as airports are concerned.
Can I intervene? We have very little time. Maybe we have time for one brief question and one brief answer.
Hello. Hi, good Hello. Morning, sir.
Morning.
Yes.
My name is Amala and I'm elected vice president of Sunrise English Private School, Abu Dhabi. I'm thankful for this opportunity. The Indian National Congress has been successful over 188 years, starting from the period of Dr. Annie Besant to transgenders being included in the central politics. My question is that women in the rural areas, the heart of India, has not been given much opportunities or attention compared to the women that we have on the central politics. So what will be your programs to actually, make the rural women the attention of central politics? And I would also like to know, most of the kids in India have underwent child abuse and child mortality. And how would you change in case if you become the Prime Minister of India?
Okay, by the way, there's the first statement you made is actually wrong. Because if you look at our political system, and if you look at our political system, maximum women's representation in our political system is actually at the village level. So we have reservation for women in Panchayati Raj, meaning all the local elections in villages and small town areas, all of them have reservations for women. And women are playing a very, very aggressive and active role in the local political scenario. That has not actually happened at the national scenario. And we are currently fighting to put reservations for women in the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. And so that is work in progress. I think that will be a big step when we give reservation to women in the Houses of Parliament. But in the rural areas, actually, they have moved ahead of the Parliament. There's been very powerful programs, particularly in the southern states, microfinance programs and self-help group programs, which have connected women to the banking system. And it's actually been revolutionary in Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka. The real problem is in North India, where the attitude towards women and the sort of approach towards women is just wrong. And it's extremely discriminatory and offensive. And I think that's where we have to change people's minds. But in South India, women's incorporation into the political system, incorporation into the economy has done pretty well comparatively. So it's a mixed bag. I think Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, this belt is where we really have to push women's empowerment and women's role in politics. It's something that we are doing, but it's difficult. Now, you're vice president, so when are you joining us?
Good one.
I really like politics, and my father is a really good politician too. As far as you know, coming into the limelight, I've been thought of IFS in case if I pass the civil service with nice marks. But politics is something which I have to, you know, really look on to. And you know, I need a lot of support and courage to become.
If you're interested, come and talk to some of us, and we'll at least explain to you what it looks like and the type of experiences
so much,
that you will face.
And you might change your mind.
You might change your mind.
Good morning, sir.
Thank you.
Because you have to have a thick skin.
We have no time. One Unfortunately, we do not have time for
last question.
Sir, okay, maybe one more.
Sam is always in a hurry.
A medical question, sir. Sorry, sir, taking a bit of your time. But good morning, sir. I'm Yogi, studying at the Gulf Medical University right now, sir. I would like to give you a brief about my story. In 2015, when I started studying in UAE, I was born and brought up in UAE throughout my life. In 2015, I was finishing my high school, that was my last year. I went back to my state in Gujarat. I went to the medical colleges over there and I asked them, will NRI students be able to enter your medical school? They told, yes, definitely, sir. You don't have to give any exams and you can come directly to us. We'll give you, if you match our criteria. I went in 2016. 1 month before, government implemented NEET, which was very unethical and it was very unfair for the NRI students. I'm not asking you for giving us more, but at least what we need, Indian students get into a normal quota without, just they get the required percentage and they get into an open quota, but NRI students have no rights. I'm not asking you for more, but at least what is needed for us.
Okay.
I'm not asking you for my career. I'm into Gulf Medical University. It's a reputed university. I have no problem. But at least for the future career coming up, I guess, for the whole NRI students present to our guys, right? NRI students, okay. At least we need what we need, sir.
Huh? No, I agree. I agree with you in principle that it should be fair. So you should... You shouldn't treat NRIs and people back home differently. So I agree with you in principle. I don't run the government of Gujarat, unfortunately.
Okay, can we?
Yeah.
Good. I think this is a good place to close.
भैया अगर आप मीडिया से हैं तो यहाँ पे स्टूडेंट्स का इंटरेक्शन हो रहा है आपसे मैं बाद में बात कर लेता हूँ
ओके कैन वी
ठीक है
एक्सक्यूज मी थैंक यू थैंक यू
बिल्कुल ठीक
थैंक यू आई एम सॉरी बट वी गॉट टू क्लोज हियर बिकॉज वी हैव अनदर स्केच
कैन आई जस्ट से टू वर्ड्स
ओके आई वांट टू से टू वर्ड्स
ओके यू से टू वर्ड्स
गो अहेड नो यू
गो अहेड फर्स्ट आई क्लोज
ओके आई जस्ट वांट टू एम्फसाइज two points from his comments. One was on brain drain. What Rahul has been saying is that it is not brain drain, but it is brain gain and brain chain. That's the idea we have in the party. We want to chain all our brains from wherever they are. Could be Amartya Sen in England, could be Raghu Rajan in US, could be somebody here. We are connected with a lot of these people and we want that bond to be stronger. Second point on education. The basic challenge in education is in three areas. Expansion, where we need more colleges, more schools, more opportunities. Excellence, the quality of our education is pretty bad, leaving aside top 5%, and equity. We have to make sure that the poorest of the poor can indeed get best education possible. And that's what he talked about. I wish we had two more hours to interact with you. There are lots and lots of interesting ideas he has on education that he and I have talked for the last 5 years on use of technology, on rechanging the entire structure. Why does it take 4 years to get a degree? Who decided that? Why should we follow that in 21st century? Why do you really need a teacher? Is teacher trained to be a mentor? All I need today is motivation, time, and content to learn. I don't need teacher. How do I do that? How do I structure education with new technology? And he has some very interesting ideas on these things, but this is not enough time. So I want to thank Mr. Rahul Gandhi. I'm sure he's going to have a few more minutes to talk. Unfortunately, we have another appointment and we can't be late. I want to thank you all. I want to thank Institute of Management Technology for hosting us. Unfortunately, we are running out of time everywhere. You know, you'll be surprised that I have requests from about 100 people on my mobile phone to see him for half an hour each in one day. The love and affection we have received here is phenomenal. Thank you all. Really appreciate. Here is the last word from Rahul.
So, couple of things I want to leave you with. Number one, you are NRIs. You have a role in India. And it's going to be a role that is going to increase. It's not going to decrease. You have knowledge, you have understanding. And this is very valuable for our country. India is facing a couple of serious problems. Number one is unemployment. We have the highest rate of unemployment we've had in over a decade. We are simply not being able to produce the jobs that we are required to produce. And it is very important that India accepts that it is facing a job crisis. Mentally accepts that, yes, we have a problem. Second, India has an agricultural crisis. And these two have to be resolved. There is no way out other than resolving these. And these two crises are going to require your help. They're going to require your service. The final thing I want to tell you is that the world is changing. It is transforming. We're moving from a world where the United States was dominant to a world where China is rising. And India has to be very clear with its positioning, its path through the next couple of decades. India cannot get into a confrontation with China. India cannot get into a confrontation with any country. But India also has to maintain its position and maintain its space. And that really is the biggest foreign policy challenge for us. You're going to see an Asian century. There's no question of it. So you are going to see a reduction of importance of Europe. You're going to see an increase in the importance of the Middle East, India, China, and other Asian regions, Turkey. And that is going to be your world. Our world, our focus used to be the United States and Europe. When we used to think about things, we used to look in that direction for ideas. Your focus is going to be much more in Asia. So that is what I wanted to leave you with. I'm very proud of what you do. And I know that you're going to serve our country and the United Arab Emirates very, very effectively. And if there's anything I can ever do, if you want to talk to me about something, if you want to complain to me about something, if you're happy about something that I've done, or maybe upset about something I've done, my doors are always open for you. I want to understand what you're thinking, and I'd also like to have a conversation with you that goes beyond just, you know, half an hour or 1 hour of talks. So anytime you're in Delhi, if you'd like to meet me, there is Mr. Nikhil Alva sitting there. You can use his services to get to me. Looking forward to seeing many of you. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. And thank you very much for having me.